Okay, so let's start this last class of the year. Do you have any question first about projects, presentations? No, nothing. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about diffusion on networks. So what I call also dynamic on networks. We have discussed in a previous class about dynamic off networks when the edges were being able to be replaced or to move or appear or disappear. Here it's dynamic on the network. So we will keep the nodes and the edges fixed, and we will have the attributes of nodes which are move and to represent some diffusion phenomenon. So of course, you are well aware that we have some biological epidemic spreading examples. Here are some examples well known in history and the current one, so I won't talk too much about that now. You already are very familiar with this question, but it's not the only type of epidemic phenomenon you can find, or spreading phenomenon you can find on networks. There is also the example of malware, of course, so virus and other things like that can spread from computer to computer through the internet, typically. Other examples are a little bit more less negative and can be social contagion. So the idea that information can spread in the network, and this information can be something positive, like a news of something that happened, or it can be misinformation, disinformation, so like fake news or things like that. But in all cases, this is also like some rumors and a diffusion of protest. So in that case, it was a study on the Arabian Spring, or other types of phenomenon. So you can have model it as a single diffusion, like a virus. You can have one piece of information which diffuses in the network, or you can model it sometimes as competing information, like maybe you have a true information and the fake news about the same topic, like I don't know, did the humans walk on the moon? Maybe you have a real information, a false information. And then they both diffuse and kind of enter in contact with each other. And this can be also modeled as competing spread, but we will not discuss this in this class. Anyway, there are many works on this idea of modeling how things spread in networks. So why on networks? Well, because in reality, many phenomena of spreading actually do appear on networks. It can be, so it's usually through interaction between agents, of course, between people, or between computers linked by cables in the internet, and so on and so forth. And the structure of this network critically influences the dynamic of spreading processes. That's what we will discuss today. So yeah, this slide, is needed. So I have to remember that I'm not an epidemiologist. So this is, I'm just really, I know these topics just not as an expert, but just as someone who sometimes use it, or I have colleagues working on that. So there are experts on networks and on diffusion on networks. And typically the people who are currently in France and in other countries working against COVID-19, some of them are network scientists. So like you have Vittoria Colizza, for instance, in France, which is working with the government on against COVID-19. She's a network scientist and an epidemiologist. So what I will say in this class is absolutely not saying anything against the models which are done by experts. On the contrary, this is just that we have maybe some point of view of how complex it is to model some spreading phenomenon on some real world, something real like COVID-19. And I have to say this because apparently last year there were some students who cited my name while on social media saying that the media were lying or something like that. So absolutely not. you have to trust the experts. They are the experts, and the experts know precisely what I'm saying here. That's why they are the experts. So everything is in accord with what the experts are saying. Yeah, and if you're interested in the topic, you can read some books like this one, for instance, but this one is a classic, but there are other ones. So first, I have to explain, if you're not familiar with it already, what are the classic models of spreading, not on networks. So first, we start with some idea that we have a population. We don't see it as a network, but just as people interacting with each other. And it's considered homogeneous. So anyone can interact with anyone. So this is the classic model, which is often used. It's used because it's simple and because it's a good model of, it's good enough for many cases. And in reality, of course, you won't consider this for the whole population, but you will create compartments. That's what they do in real models. Like you will consider a child, you will consider adults who work in health and so on and so forth. So for all of them, you consider them mostly as some homogeneous population. And and that's it. So these models, we will call them, so the three we will talk about as SI, SIR, and CIS models, where the letters correspond to the states that people can be in. So people can be susceptible, so they are not infected. So S is susceptible, I is infected, individual is infected by what we are spreading. And then you have the R, which is recovered or removed. So people being cured or being dead, which for us is the same thing. In that case, we consider that they are now impossible to reinfect. That's the important thing, but I will go back to that. So all individuals must be in one of those states. So that's what we define. So they are one or the other. And we will note like this, small s, as the fraction of individuals which are in susceptible state at time t. Okay, so this can be like 0.5. It means that half the population is susceptible at that time. Same thing for infected and recovered. And this zero here, I zero, means that at time zero, so at the beginning, we have a given fraction of people who are infected. So we start with some, if you have no one infected, of course, you cannot have a spread. So you cannot have a diffusion. So you need to start with even 1, 2, 3, 10% of people who are infected. So here are the three models. The SI just means that when someone is susceptible, it can become infected. And when this person is infected, that's it. You stay infected. In the SIS, you have people who can get infected with some probability. And then they can go back to the status that they are when they were susceptible with a different probability. And then you have the SIR, in which people are susceptible, then they become infected, and then finally they recover. So when they recover, as I said, they cannot become infected anymore or susceptible anymore. So of course, these are the simplest models. It has been shown, for instance, that these models are too simple to model COVID, because in the COVID, you have some step here where you're infected, but you do not know it, for instance. And this will completely change how the diffusion process will occur, because it changed the way people interact with you, because they don't know you are infected, and so on and so forth. So these are simple models, but they are simple enough to see the points we will make in this class. Can we use them for fake news?
Yeah.
If it's some news, You can consider that when you're convinced, so you're in that state, and you maybe it's this is enough because you won't change. Or you might consider that when you got an information, maybe you're convinced, but you can change your mind and go back to another opinion, maybe. So it's really a choice that you have to make. Yes, and of course there are many different processes. Here it's really the simplest one, but for someone which are also interesting, for instance, consider that for information, that it will depend on, yeah, that it's not linear with, like, if you have more friends that have this opinion, then you have more chance to be convinced, okay? And it's not linear with the number of friends. Like, maybe if you have only one friend who gives this opinion, you have zero chance to be convinced. And if you have a majority of your friends that have this opinion, then you're nearly certain to be convinced, for instance. So in this case, it's different from what we have. But yeah. So in the non-network, in the homogeneous approach, homogeneous mixing approach, so we consider that any individual can interact with any other. We consider that the population has a finite size, okay? And individuals have an average number of contacts per unit of time. So we consider that each person will interact with 5 other persons every unit of time. And then we will add a probability to infect those people. So this is the principle of the SI model. You define some infectivity. So the infectivity here is the probability that the contact between an infected individual and the susceptible one result in the infection of the susceptible. So when they come into contact, what is the probability that there is a spread, that the person become infected? There is the contact rate, so the average number of contacts per person per time, as I was saying. And then this effective contact rate beta, which we will mostly use later, which is simply the multiplication of the two other ones. So it's the number of newly infected individuals by each infected individual in a population in which everyone else is susceptible. So if you consider that, of course, if everyone is already in the infected state, then this does not really make sense, because even if you have interaction with people and you have some probability to get them infected, if they are already all infected, you won't infect anyone. But if you consider that no one else is infected, then beta will be the number of new persons which will be infected, okay? Just number of contact, probability to infect someone by a contact. And this is what defines the diffusion. And then you start with some infected node, and you check after the next step what's going on. So new nodes got infected, and then new ones, and so on and so forth. So here, note that there is the node's position does not have any meaning, right? Homogeneous. You could just consider it's a theoretical model in which you don't run simulation, you just compute the number of people who will get infected in this population without assuming anything about the way the contact happens. So here is a characteristic of this model. So you can define the rate of the new infection. So this will tell you how many people get infected at the next step. So if you're at step I, you want to know how many people will get infected at I plus one, let's say, in a discrete interpretation of the model. And this is simply this rate of infecting people times the number of people who are infected. So number of people who are infected, each of them have this rate of infection of others. And then you have to also multiply by the fraction of susceptible to take into account that if everyone is already infected, then you cannot infect new people, okay? And this number of susceptible in this model, SI, since we have only infected and susceptible, of course, susceptible is just one minus I, one minus those who are not infected are susceptible. Okay, so those who are infected have this tendency to infect others, And it also depends on how many people can yet be infected. And from this equation, you can have another, you can compute the equation of the number of people who will get infected at some time t. So for any t, like we will want to see after at t equals 10, at t equals 15, so 0.1, 0.2, and so on and so forth. You want to know what is the fraction of the population that will be infected. So I won't detail how you get this, but basically what you see is that there is an exponential here. It's the famous exponential growth of a diffusion in a population. And you can do the same with the susceptible fraction, which is just one minus the number of infected, since again, you can be only infected or susceptible. Okay, yeah. Yeah, yes, it's solving differential equation. So, yeah, and this is kind of the definition of an exponential. You see, if you don't think about the s, like you have the I, which is the previous I multiplied by something. So this is typically what gives an exponential. So if you look at how it looks, this and you plot it, this diffusion on the network, you see that you have this exponential outbreak. So in the beginning, you're starting with an exponential growth. But then, of course, at the end, everyone gets infected because in the SI model, there is no limit. Everyone can infect anyone and there is no reason for it to stop, at least, yeah. And so it starts with an exponential growth, then it slows, it's reach a peak here of a speed of diffusion. And then there is a saturation. There is a saturation because at the end there are less people who are susceptible to get infected. So you cannot infect as many people every step. So it saturates until the last people get infected. Okay, it's because since you have this one minus I here, this becomes smaller and smaller. So when you get close to the end, this will make it small, while it gets the faster when both of them are in the middle. When you will have the population is infected, it's the fastest rate of diffusion. And yeah, that basically that's everything here. And so you might say, okay, but this is not really a very realistic example of diffusion. Well, here is, for instance, what's going on with some example of technology adoption. If you plot the curve of the fraction of people in the US who have, I don't know, like a cloth washer, air conditioning, computer, and so on and so forth. So it's not looking exactly like the previous plot, but you kind of see some similarity. Like in the beginning, when you have some new, something new coming in, especially for recent things like computers, you have this phenomenon of in the beginning of an exponential growth, like everyone wants a TV, everyone wants a cell phone, so everyone buys it. And then at the end, it's kind of slowing down because there are some people who still don't want, so in this case, it's a little bit different reasons, like it's really maybe some people who are hard to convince, and then you get if you want to model this, you need to maybe add some additional elements, but still you get this idea of something that when you get a TV, well, you don't, you will get, you stay infected, you still have your TV and you won't go back to the state where you don't have a TV.
Maybe one good example that we can obtain from Google data is the vaccination power. And we can see that the percentage of the vaccination power is exactly like what we have seen on the
vaccine. I mean, the fraction of people get vaccinated. Yes. Yeah, it can be also a good example. But all, of course, in all these examples, there are some biases because it's human made. So there are some personal reasons for why people get vaccinated or not. It's mandatory, kind of mandatory in many countries. So of course, but you're right that it will also probably look something like that. And I think it's probably a good, the reasons are similar in the beginning. Like it's really like people get kind of infected by social contagion. They see people who get vaccinated. So they say, yeah, it's probably a good thing. I can do it now. Even if at the beginning I was not certain, but still I see many of my friends doing it. So I will do it too. So I think the beginning is a good, the SI can be a good model. But then at the end, of course, you have some people who will never get vaccinated. While they, in the case of the homogeneous mixing, they will get infected because it's, you cannot refuse to get infected, right, by a virus or something. So adding another element, but yeah, of course, what is this model, the SI model, is good just to think about the speed of the diffusion, for instance, something like that. So then you have the SIS model in which you can go back to, you can recover with a certain ratio. So that in that case, it's for each node. Each node can recover with a certain probability, does not depend on the others. And you can define exactly in the same ways your rate of new infection. And in that case, you see that it's the same as before, like this is the same as before, but you have to remove the fraction of nodes which are becoming, which are recovering. So, going back to the susceptible state. And so you have to remove your parameter times the fraction of infected. So the more each infected person has a probability to become susceptible again. Okay. So this might, this might model something like the common cold, when you get a cold and then you're susceptible again and you can get another cold later. So what is interesting here is that you can see from this equation that you will not reach this time a maximum of one where everyone is infected at the end. So you still have the same exponential growth in the beginning. And then you saturate with something which is with some value that you can know beforehand, which is this mu, so this chance of being susceptible and divided by the beta. So basically, the higher chance you have to become susceptible again, so kind of recover. And if you have a high chance, then you will saturate at a low number. And if you have here a low value, you will saturate at a high number. So you will become close to one. And what is interesting with this model is that we can start to think about the R0. So this famous R0 that we kind of say that it should be below one for the phenomenon, spreading phenomenon to stop. And so it's actually computed on like this. And what it just tells you this is that you compare the fraction of people who get infected at each new iteration, new timestamp, you get compute the person number of people who get infected, and you compare it with the number of people who recover. So basically, if it's equal, if it's above one, it means that you have more people getting infected than people recovering, and if it's below one, it means that you have more people recovering than people getting infected. So naturally, if it's above one, you have a phenomenon spread because you get people, more people infected than recovering. And you see that it's an exponential growth because you see that, for instance, if this lambda or R0 is equal to two, this means that you start with one then you get 2 people infected, then you get 4, then 8, 16, and so on and so forth, because each new person at with a given time step is infecting 2 new people. So you have an exponential growth. So if it's just above 1 and you're running a simulation, then the outbreak can stop naturally by chance in the beginning. But if you get like 10% of the population infected, then you cannot stop it, and your only chance is to do something about those things, like to try to, for instance, to reduce either to improve the mu or to reduce the beta. And to reduce the beta, well, you can for instance remove the number of contacts that people have, because remember it's the fraction, it's a chance to infect someone when you interact with it, times the number of interactions. So if you limit the number, so this is reducing the probability to infect people when you meet them, and when you forbid to do some to people to go to restaurants, well, you limit the number of contact that people have. So you're acting on this beta. And finally, the SIR, in which you add now this recovery rate. So in this time, in this case, when you recover, you don't go back to susceptible, but you go to a recovery rate in which we will consider that you cannot get infected. And again, same types of equations. With the initial steps still follow an exponential growth, you have the fraction of infected nodes reach a peak and then decreases like this. So sorry, I cannot move the, you don't see it anyway. Okay. The fraction of recovery saturates, of recovered saturates below 1. The fraction of susceptible do not necessarily reach 0. And the delta ratio is defined as before, but instead of mu, you have this, you have the probability to get into recovered state. Okay, so it's relatively similar, but now you have this fraction of infected, which will decrease, because when people are infected, they can go back to the recovered. And recovered actually also is a way to count how many people got infected in total. So this tells you how many people got infected, and is similar to what you had here. But in that case, the difference, main difference, is that the spreading stops at some point, contrary to here, when you reach a stable point. So as I said, these are just examples of spreading processes, very simple phenomenon, way to model processes. You have also this one, you can just search for them if you're interested. With other, like I said, the majority rule, which is a common way to model a diffusion of opinions. So you tend to have the same opinion as the majority of people around you. But yes, so these are more complex phenomenon. Okay, so this was on an homogeneous population, but the point of the class, of course, is to see how this translates for networks. So obviously, the homogeneous mixing approach is unrealistic, because populations are organized in networks, and the question is, does it make a difference? So you see that. When you, in that case, instead of saying that anyone can infect anyone in the population, we will get constrained by the properties of the graph. So you can infect only your direct neighbors, clearly. So does the organization influence the spread? Well, in certain cases, yes, clearly. Like if you have something like this, your network looks like that. So maybe when people when there is a lockdown, the network is split in different parts, and you cannot have a diffusion from this part to this part. And also maybe the diffusion from this part to this part is difficult because you have to go through this particular edge here. So yes, in that case, clearly it affects the way the diffusion will occur in the network. In this case, also, if you start in the middle, for instance, you will have a diffusion to everyone in the network, but it's constrained by space and it won't occur randomly, and it will kind of be relatively slow to reach this part of the graph, because at every time step you can only go one hop more. So you have to, if you have five, a distance of five between the beginning and the end, you know that all these nodes, they are safe for a certain period of time, the time that it reaches by hops due to this kind of special organization here. On the contrary, when you see something like that, where everyone is kind of connected to everyone, or there is a star, so there are only two hops between every node, when you can guess that this might make the spread go very fast, because if you start with this one, it's very different than when you start with this one. If this one is infected, it can infect all the others. While if you start here, you first need to infect this one, and then you can infect all the others. So the question is, if I have now some network, more complicated, will it affect the spread or not? Or can I keep my equations? So just a point on notation, we have a problem here on networks, is that this number of contacts per unit of time does not make sense anymore, because this is decided by the structure of the network. Maybe for one node, it can have, we consider that each time step, it can infect five people because it has five edges, but another node has 100. So it can infect 100 persons. So this number of contacts does not make sense in the network. So what we take as a notation usually in the literature, what is used, is that we consider that the beta is actually what was before this tau. So this parameter, this probability to infect someone with a contact, actually is equivalent to what we will now use as a beta. So beta means, for each neighbor, what is the probability to infect it? And so this probability to infect a neighbor will result in more people infected for a hub than for a node of small degree. Okay, so just remember that now we use beta, and that this beta means, what is the probability that one of my neighbors get infected? So I roll a dice at every simulation, I roll a dice for each neighbor, and for each neighbor, if I'm infected, I have a probability to infect it, which is beta. So the first question is, what's going on if I have a homogeneous network? It means a network in which all nodes have exactly the same degree. Okay, so I consider that I try to replace my C here by K. K is the degree of node. And I say, okay, I had this model on a homogeneous population. And I said, in average, each people will interact with five other people for every time unit. And now I say each node has a degree of five, and everything else is a random network. Random network, fixed degree, degree equals to C. Does it change something in the equation? Well, the good news is no. So if you have, you had the equation for the homogeneous mixing, and if you compare it here with the equation for the homogeneous network, and you remember that here this beta times the average degree is in fact equals to this beta, which is the tau times the C. So actually these two equations are similar. So what this tells you is that the good news is that if you have a random network with fixed degrees, then the diffusion is very similar to an homogeneous population, homogeneous mixing. And the other good news is that if you take an Erdős-Rényi random graph, So where the so you just use this model in which we know that the distribution of degree is Poissonian, and it's centered on some average value, the value of degree. Then if you consider that your degree, so you don't have exactly the same degree for all the nodes, but you have an average degree, which is equals to this k, then it's the same. It does not change the result. The only difference are due to some discrete cases, the fact that you do it in a discrete way, and so you have more chance to have something that disappear in the beginning due to some random fluctuation in your network. But basically, otherwise, the diffusion is exactly the same, has exactly the same shape. So we have also to be careful with the notation with the R0, because in R0, again, you have to replace this beta by this beta k in the case of an Erdős-Reinl random graph. So either you say that your R0 is defined like this, or you say that you keep the same definition as before of the R0. You say my R0 is beta divided by mu. But in that case, I have to be careful that my threshold is not one, but it's one divided by the average degree. Okay, but it does not change the result. It's just to say that since this beta is just a probability to infect any other person, then if it's above the average degree, then I will infect more people in average at every time unit than people will recover. So the problem is when you're dealing with graphs that do not have, which are not completely, where the degree is not Poissonian, but when you have some heterogeneous degree distribution. And in that case, what you do is that, well, you have to do some approximations to try to get some result of how the diffusion takes place. So usually people use a degree block. One way to do is to use a degree block approximation in which you will compute for all nodes having a certain degree. So you will take them and you will look at what are the degrees of nodes of this degree, this particular degree. And then you can compute for each set of nodes with a given degree, what is the probability to get infected. So you calculate the global average by your sum considering the degree distribution. So for all the degrees, you will compute this rate of infection depending of the probability of having the fraction of nodes that have this particular degree. We know that all nodes are infected in the end. For the SI model, what may vary is the speed of the process. So we know that for the SI model, we know that anyway everyone will get infected at the end, the same thing. But depending of the distribution of degrees, you will have a faster diffusion. So you can compute it for nodes here of a given degree, so degree k. And you take for all the nodes with a given degree, you keep the same, you have an equation which is very similar, but in which you consider only the nodes with a given degree k. So you can now have this, you know that it's not the average degree here, but it's exactly this node, they have exactly this degree. And you have to compute the fraction of the node of this degree which are infected, and the fraction of infected node among all nodes having this degree. Okay. And so from this, what you can show is that the time scale of the process which is a measure process inversely proportional to its speed, it's something like this. And what you can see from it is that it depends on the second moment. And this second moment, as we have seen, is larger when you have an heterogeneous degree distribution. So for a given average degree, so if you have a given average degree, then you know that the more heterogeneous is the degree distribution, the faster will be the spread. Okay, so the more heterogeneous the degree, the faster the diffusion. And we have seen also that when we have a power law degree distribution, then this second moment can diverge. So this tells you that if you have this, if you're in a situation in which you have the second moment which is diverging, then you can have a near instantaneous diffusion in the network. So what does it say? What does it mean in practice? Well, it's pretty simple to understand. Is that if you have this second moment which is diverging, it tells you that basically you have one node connected to anyone else in the network. And since you have one node connected to everyone else in the network, what happens is that when this node is infected, well, it can infect everyone else in the network very quickly. And since we are here in a SI model, well, the node stays infected. So at every time unit, the node will try to infect all the other nodes in the network. So obviously this will result in a very, very fast diffusion, right? So even if you start with a node which is at the which is not the hub here, as soon as this one will get infected, then diffusion is extremely fast. So we can check this in practice with some experiments. Here, you do your SI process, and you have time on the horizontal axis, and the fraction of infected on the vertical axis. And what you see is that if we, depending on our second moment here, if it's small, so if the degree distribution is looking like a Poissonian, maybe, you will have some speed of diffusion. And then as soon as, while the variance of the degree distribution is increasing, you see that it's getting faster and faster until reaching something extremely fast here. Nearly instantaneous. So it can also be shown that the epidemic threshold so is not reached like before when you have this value which is above one, but when this lambda is above, so the square of the average degree divided by this second moment. And so what for a given degree, again, this tells you that you can have some, so this R0 value can actually, it means that you can have a diffusion which will spread even though the value of lambda is actually not superior to one, but it can be below one because of this problem that you have when a hub is infected, it can spread to anyone else. And so even though you have some probability to, well, you have so the more your distribution is heterogeneous, the more this will become big, the more this will become this threshold will become low, and the more with the same average degree, a same beta and the same mu, so same parameters of the diffusion, the more you still have a chance to get a diffusion to the whole network, even though you don't have such a large probability to well, you don't have such a large lambda. So just to finish, some points about, so there are not so many actually theoretical work on how the organization of the network in terms of communities might in fact might affect the diffusion. But what you can see is that the fact that there are communities in the network have a strong effect, because you might have something like what they call here structural trapping, in which when you have some people infected in a community, we know that they will tend to, community is a definition that you have a lot of edges inside and few edges outside. So if you infect a community, this will increase the number of chance of infecting people who are inside the community, and you have less chance that the diffusion goes outside of the community. So you will have some diffusion which stays inside the community. So that's what is called structural trapping here. So for instance, when you have a diffusion like a virus, an epidemic, and epidemic spreading, and you kind of try to close a little bit the frontiers between countries. Well, in the country, the diffusion can go on, but it's more difficult to spread to different countries. So that's why it's not homogeneous in the whole world, let's say. And you also have, so this means that you stay trapped in the community, but it also means that inside the community, you have a strong chance that everyone gets infected very fast, because inside the community, we know that it tends to be dense, the connection tends to be dense with many triangles. So if you're not infected, so you have many chances to be infected by all the other people in the community every time. So inside the community, compared with a random network, if you have a network which has communities, you will go faster, the diffusion will go faster inside the communities and slower to move to other communities. So to illustrate this, you can do some experiments. For instance, this is the experiment with scale-free models. So in that case, it's an SIR. It's an SIR in which we choose different values of the parameter of the degree distribution. Here, you remember that's between 2 and 4. And we compare with an Erdős-Reinl random graph. And what we observe is that, so with some given parameters here, I don't go into the details, but what you observed is that when you increase your heterogeneity of degrees, you will get a faster, kind of a faster diffusion. So you see that you get more people infected faster than in the Erdős-Reinl random graph. So the diffusion of the structure of the network do affect the speed of the diffusion. Again, if you do the same experiment but with some control community structure, so you decide on some number on blocks, and then you vary the fraction of the edges which are inside the block or between the blocks. So you have a community structure which is stronger or weaker. And it seems that here in the beginning, you get something which is similar to the Erdős-Reinl. So if your community structure is not strong, it won't affect the diffusion. But then when your community structure start to be strong, so with as many edges inside than outside, so it means in that case, I've seen there are less not pairs inside the communities than between them. So it means that the communities are dense and between communities is not as dense. So you see that this will slow down the rate at which people get infected. And so the more strong is the community structure, the slower is the diffusion in the network. And finally, we can also have a look at what's going on with a special structure, as I was showing before, some structure like this, or more simply, some Watt-Strogatz structure in which you can control that in the beginning you have everyone on a circle, and then you try to add some shortcuts to see how this affects the speed of the diffusion. And what you observe here is that the Erdős-Reni is a blue line, so it's the faster. And when you add the some special constraint, so you don't randomize, but you keep this circle-like structure, then of course it makes the diffusion slower because you can only affect your neighbors. And so you cannot use a shortcut to move to a different part of the network and go there to infect everyone. So some discussion about application of what we know about networks for epidemics. So when one possibility to use this is to do model fitting, so to better know and observe diffusion. So for instance, if you have some data about a network representing, it can be at the level node can represent cities or it can represent people, but usually we don't have the network at the level of people, but it can represent also neighborhoods, it can represent like some regions just. Then you know, if you know who gets infected and how, you can build some model of it and try to model the diffusion by modifying some parameters of the diffusion. So with a higher beta, with a higher mu, or modifying these kind of things, modifying the properties of the network. And you can try to make a model that better represents what you observe. And this can help you to think about what's going on. Is there some, when, for instance, in this case, the goal is to understand. But you can also use, when you have this, for instance, this model which is fitted on the data, you can try to predict future trends. So you can try to make some informed guess about if I increase my beta, if I reduce the number of edges between this part and this part, how will it affect the diffusion, and so on and so forth. So again, in that case, the modification can be on. So for the modeling, you can modify the structure of your network and see how it affects the diffusion, or you can keep your network constant and consider that this is network how it is, and see how. So I don't know if I pick about it. Yeah, it's just later. If you want to control the epidemic, you can also check what happens if you do some targeted vaccination, for instance. So if you consider that you have the possibility to vaccinate people, but you can do it in different ways. You can do it randomly, or you can choose some people and say that they are more important to vaccinate. And you can check by working on the network, what is the influence of vaccinating one people or another. Of course, here I'm talking about theoretical models, not real people, real network of interaction observed between people. But for instance, we have seen that when we have a heterogeneous degree distribution, it increases the speed at which people get infected. So if you target your vaccination to people that have a high degree, then you will probably slow down the rate of diffusion, and that's exactly what we do usually with vaccination. So not for COVID, because it's extremely fast and it's a little bit different, and the good solution is to vaccinate everyone. But it was used, for instance, when fighting against AIDS, so against SIDA, en français, that if you actually study the network of sexual interaction between people, you find that there are some typical hubs in this network. And these hubs are unfortunately like prostitutes. And if you vaccinate specifically these people, then you're very efficient at stopping the diffusion in this particular network. Well, because you're blocking the diffusion that goes very fast through those nodes. Another fun usage of some network properties is the usage that was proposed of the friend paradox. So if you imagine that you have some shots to vaccinate people, but it's limited, so you have to choose who you vaccinate. So, okay, maybe you can vaccinate people who have the most, if you know them, if you already know the people with the highest degree in the network, the best is to vaccinate them, probably. But all those with a high betweenness, for instance, because you know that they play the role of bridge. So if you vaccinate the bridge, you impede, you forbid the diffusion to go from one part to the other. But let's say that you don't really know who are the hubs of your network. Then what is mathematically a good way to proceed is to vaccinate random contacts of random nodes. So it seems counterfactual, but it's actually because of this friend paradox that we already discussed, that if you take some random node and then you take a random neighbor of this random node, then you have a good chance to get a high degree node. Okay, because high degree nodes are connected to more people. So mathematically, it's an efficient way to proceed. So you could imagine, like, ask people who they take some random person. You take a random person. You ask to that person who this person has interacted with in the last 3 days, and you take one of those person at random, and then you kind of getting automatically hubs. And so you're doing some efficient vaccination. So with the same number of shots, instead of giving it to random people, you ask to random people to give random the contacts they had before, and you vaccinate those people. And it just naturally makes sense, because if you think if I ask you who you had a contact, like contact in terms of being at face to face at less than 3 meters in the previous days, well, you have your friends, but you also have the shop assistant that you interacted with, and this shop assistant, they interact with many different people. Or if you have kids, well, probably these kids, they also had, you don't have maybe many contacts with your colleagues because you try to avoid contact, but the kids, they probably had contacts with also many different people, and with the teacher in particular. If you ask the kid, you will get the teacher, and so on and so forth. So that's a strategy. Of course, I think it has never been used in practice, and it will never, because it has some problems. But it's easier to just do some social analysis and find the node with the highest degree. But in theory, it works. Okay, so I'm done with the slides, and the idea is that in the experiments, you will do some diffusion on the airport dataset and check things like how, if you vaccinate some airports, how it affects the diffusion.